Thank you so much. That was wonderful. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Medford United Methodist Church. My name is Joe Monahan. I want to welcome you on behalf of myself and also our associate pastor, Kathleen Stoltz. We're really happy to have you with us this morning. And I hope that each one of you will take the red attendance pad that's on the inside of the pew, that you'll pass it down. It's one of the ways that we get to know one another's names. And if you are visiting with us, especially if you're visiting with us for the first time, we encourage you to share at the bottom of the page your name and address information so that we can let you know about things that are going on here at the church. We'd love the opportunity to do that. And if you'd like to learn more about the church, you can always check out our website, and there's also some information out in the hallway as well. So we thank you for coming, and again, if you're a first-time visitor, we are really happy to have you with us here this morning. I want to thank everyone who helped us with the Dickens Festival last night. This is always a big event in the life of the church and in the life of the community, to be honest. We provide the live nativity there, and I want to thank everybody who helped in all kinds of different ways. We had some folks go over during the week and set up the manger scene and all of that kind of stuff. We had people had to wrangle animals and bring the lights and make the hot chocolate, and some of you made cookies, and it was a great evening, and I'm really grateful to all of you. It's a great witness and a great outreach to the community, so thank you for your help with that. I want to thank also the trustees. If you've not been to Boker Hall, just right up this way, if you've not been there in the past week, we did replace the ceiling in Boker Hall this week. It's part of a project to renovate Boker over the next couple of months, and this was the first stage of it. It was a really important one because we're going into the winter, and it provided a lot of new insulation, which is important in that space. But I really want to thank the trustees, in particular Paul Martin and Bill Frame, who coordinated that work this week. It was a big job, and there was a lot of cleanup to do when it was all done, so I'm really grateful to them. I want to lift up a couple of opportunities to serve, and one in particular, the Angel Tree, is happening. We're partners with a lot of different organizations. We're collecting gifts, and if you'd like to learn more, you can find out about the opportunities that are available out in the hallway. A couple of special opportunities to worship coming up for the next couple of weeks. The choir would love you to know that the choir candlelight service is coming up a week from today. And then the next week beyond that, the Bells would love for you to know that the Bell concert is coming up. So the 13th and the 20th, mark your calendars and check out those announcements in the bulletin. Finally, I just want to lift up the times of our Christmas Eve services because we will soon be at that day. And so we have four services this year. We've got a 5 o'clock service, it's gonna be family service, 7 o'clock service in the sanctuary. The new one is the 9 o'clock service. That's gonna be up in Boker Hall, and that's going to have, we're gonna have the band playing for that. So that's one that's new, and we're looking forward to that. And then the 11 o'clock service here in the sanctuary with both candlelight and communion. So we invite you to check out those and come join us. I think those are all the announcements that we've got.
One more announcement. If you've had your portraits taken already for the pictorial directory, we have, and if you've ordered some, we have them ready for you. So you can pick them up at the end of the service. But if you haven't yet signed up, please do so. The sign-up sheet is right out that door on the wall by the ladies' room. And if you are a regular attender but not yet a member, you know, we need to know your name and face. So we'd love to have you in the directory too. This is not just for the members. This is for all of us who are actively engaged in ministry here. So we hope that you'll be part of that. And now we invite you to stand for our opening hymn. You may be seated. Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God with prayer. As we light the first candle, we light this candle of hope. And now we light this candle for peace.
Good morning. Good morning. Hear God's promise of peace from Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. Let us pray. Faithful God, you are at work restoring all of creation in its intended harmony. Grace us with your shalom, that we may be reconciled to all enemies in the peace that passes all understanding.
God, the promise and hope, come into our hearts with your distinctive peace that passes all understanding. Amen.
I invite you now to join me in our opening prayer. Come to me, Jesus says, all you who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death.
On you has the light shone.
For Jesus is the light of the world, and this is the story. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness could not be put out.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the bright and morning star.
We join with the angels in their hymns of praise. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace. Alleluia. Let's take a moment now for some silent prayer. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let's take a moment now to greet those around us with the peace of Christ.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite our children to come up now for some time together. Oh, I'm glad you found them again and you brought them back with you. The world looks a lot clearer now, right? Yeah. Do you use them for reading or do you use them for distance?
Just
for inside. Okay. Okay. Well, we are in the season of Advent as we are waiting for Christmas. Now, what happened to your glasses? I just realized. Carolyn's got hers and Ethan forgot his. Lost them? Oh, dear. Okay. So, yes? You're getting a Christmas tree today. That's great. That's one of the things we do when we are waiting for Christmas. We get all kinds of things ready. Well, the story that we're going to hear from the Bible today is about a baby. Now, it's not about baby Jesus. It's about a different baby named John. Brown eyes, and this is baby Peach. I brought baby Peach just to remind us about how big a baby is. Babies are pretty little, aren't they? Do your parents tell you about the story when you were born or when you came into their family? Do you ever hear stories about when you came into their family? Yes, and so sometimes those stories are so much fun about when we were really, really tiny. And well, we can talk about it later, okay? You can tell me that funny story later. Would that be good? All right, we'll catch up later. So today's Bible reading is about the birth of John. And his daddy was so happy when he was born that he had a very special song that he sang. Now, I'm not going to sing you a song, but you're going to hear it in a few minutes, hear it read. But sometimes parents have wonderful, wonderful hopes and dreams for children. So, for example, Carolyn, when you were born, your parents might have hoped that you were going to be tall and smart and maybe a dancer. Or most of all, though, we hope that our children will be happy and that they live in a place of peace and that they know the love of God. So by bringing you all to Sunday school and to church, you're all learning about the love of God. And baby John's parents brought him to the temple and taught him all about God so that when he grew up, you know what he did? He told other people all about God and all about Jesus and all about what they should do to live according to God's commandments. And you can all do that too. You can just be like John. You can grow up and tell other people, even now at your age, you can tell other people about God and about Jesus. So baby John, his dad's name was Zechariah. And Zechariah really hoped that John was going to grow up and tell other people about peace. So can you do that too? Tell people about peace and about God's love? Do you think you can do that? Yeah? That's what Christmas is all about. And so you can do that too. You can grow up and you can even start right now. Her eyes don't close. Don't pull her eyelashes out. My granddaughter would be very unhappy. Yeah. Baby Peach lives at my house when my granddaughter comes. So. Okay, let's pray for a few minutes and then we can go back to our seats. Loving God, we do give you thanks for baby John the Baptist coming into our lives and for your son, Jesus, coming into our lives. Help us to live lives of peace and to teach others how to love one another. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up, guys.
Thank you.
Mary, rock, rock, rock your little baby, rock your child in the stable tonight. Oh, Mary, rock, rock, rock your little baby, rock your baby in the heavenly light. Oh, Mary, rock, rock.
We're going to move to the New Testament now, the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 57 through 79. Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown his great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. On the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him Zechariah after his father. But his mother said, "No, he is to be called John." They said to her, "None of your relatives have this name." Then they began motioning to his father to find out what name he wanted to give him. He asked for a writing tablet and wrote, "His name is John." All of them were amazed. Immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue freed, and he began to speak, praising God. Fear came over all their neighbors. And all these things were talked about throughout the entire hill country of Judea. All who heard them pondered them and said, "What then will this child become? For indeed the hand of the Lord was with him." Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy: "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors, and he has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High. And you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. So we continue this week with a series we started a couple weeks ago. It's called The Original Christmas Carols, and we're looking at some of the texts in the first couple of chapters of Luke that look a lot to us like poetry, that look like they might have been sung. And this song we call the Song of Zechariah, the Benedictus, which comes from the Latin for the first word of that text in Latin. It's the next thing that we're going to talk about. So I encourage you, let's be in prayer together for just a moment. God, we're grateful for all that you've done. We're grateful for the way that you're at work and have been at work in our lives. And we pray that in these moments, as we consider again the words of the scriptures that you've given to us, that you might be at work in our hearts, in our minds, in our hearing, and in our understanding, so that we might take these words that you've given us and that we might practice them. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If I can be very honest, there are times when I really question whether faith has a greater capacity for saving the world or for destroying the world. I really wrestle with that sometimes. I see someone attack a women's clinic in Colorado. I see someone attack a Christmas party in San Bernardino. Both of them acting, they say, out of faith. You know, last week I talked about joy. Sometimes joy is a hard thing to come by. Sometimes, I don't know about you, but I cannot help but get angry. I get angry when I see how easy it is for some people to take a life. I get angry when I see how easy it is for some people to destroy the world rather than to work to make the world better. And when I see them doing this in the name of God, I become very angry. But there's also this part of me that somehow, strangely, wants to apologize for it. Even if that person who did this is not from my tribe, even if they don't even follow the same religion that I do, I feel some responsibility for it. And I'm not sure exactly why, but I do. Perhaps it's because I know that there are millions of people who see what happens on the news and are sitting in front of their TVs and saying, "Look, honey, I told you, religion is no good. Faith doesn't move the human race forward. It just holds us back and causes us pain." And I know that there are millions and millions of people who say that every single time something like this happens. It doesn't matter who does it, or whose God is being served. But people have the same reaction. We saw some of that this week. Imagine if you're on Facebook. This was, you know, a great debate I saw on a lot of pages and a lot of people that I am friends with about the idea of, should we pray or should we work? So on the front page of the Daily News in New York, it was the headline, "God Isn't Fixing This." And there's more to that story when you get into reading it. But the way that people were responding, the way Christians were responding to this was the idea of, well, we need to stop praying and start doing something. In other words, prayer doesn't do anything. It doesn't work. It doesn't help. And I understand that to some degree. I understand the idea that words are cheap. Now, that phrase doesn't carry weight with us because it isn't true. We understand that it is true. But if words are so cheap, then at the same time, how can we say that all the anti-abortion rhetoric could have led people to this act in Colorado Springs? How can we say that all the anti-police rhetoric could have led us to see officers shot? Words do mean something. If people are losing their lives over them, then words mean something. And as someone who finds his worth primarily in the words that he's able to use, I mean, after all, isn't that what preaching is? Isn't that what you pay me to do? Someone who finds his worth primarily in the words that I use, I certainly do believe that words make a difference. But today's scripture is an example of a moment in time when words simply failed. So this is the story of Zechariah. And if you don't know anything about Zechariah, Zechariah was a priest. He was, at the time when his son John was born, he was an older man, married to an older woman. And neither one of them had ever expected that they would have a child. They had gotten past that point in their lives. They had reconciled themselves to, you know, this isn't going to happen for us. But one day, when John goes to work and he is serving in the temple, he's in at the altar by himself, in the holiest space in the temple. He sees an angel standing. And the angel says to him, "Zechariah, there's news. You and your wife Elizabeth, you'll have a baby. And not only that, Zechariah, but this child will be great. He will be a great servant of the Most High God. Perhaps the greatest servant to come ever before the greatest servant who ever would come." This was good news in every possible way, not only for Zechariah as an individual, but for the whole world. But the irony is, in this moment of Zechariah's greatest triumph, he's unable to say anything. He's unable to share that message with anyone. So if you noticed in today's passage, when they say, "What is the child's name to be?" Zechariah has to write it on a tablet because God has not yet freed his tongue to be able to say the name of the child. So he's silenced in the moment of his greatest triumph. And the way that we understand this, the way this story is told, is that when the angel shares this news with Zechariah, he says, "How can this be? How will I know that this thing is to pass?" If I had been the angel, I personally would have said, "Well, I think you're going to know when your wife's pregnant," right? But that was his question. How will I know that this thing's true? How will I know? And because of his doubt, it says that he's unable to speak. He's unable to share this message. And so for 9 months, he is silent. He's silent. And I feel this tension within myself as we come into the season of the year. We have the greatest news that has ever been told. The message that God loves us, and furthermore, that God wants to be with us. That God's willing to come into this world to be with us. To use the language of Zechariah's song, after he's able to speak again, God is sending us a mighty Savior, the one who brings salvation to his people, the one who brings forgiveness of sins. In him, dawn breaks upon us. Light for all those who have sat in the shadow of death. And all of these things are true. And yet, so often our witness is like that of Zechariah. It is silent, not only as individuals, but as a church. And I think that there's a connection between why Zechariah is silent and why we are silent. See, in Zechariah's case, he hears this message from the angel and he says, if I go and I share this with people, I don't know who's going to believe it. It just doesn't make any sense. Well, I have a feeling, too, that we wonder whether if when we share this message with others, whether they will believe it. Because there are certain pieces of the picture that don't make sense to us. It didn't make sense to Zechariah that he and his wife would suddenly be blessed with a child after all of these years. And it doesn't make any more sense for God to send us a Savior who's described both in but with both of these terms. First one is the idea that the Savior promises to save us from our enemies and from the hand of all those who hate us. Now that sounds like a pretty good thing right now, does it not? That sounds like something that we need. But there's another piece to the story, and that is that we've also been promised a Savior who will guide our steps in the way of peace. Now, I want you just to sit with that for a moment, to think about the idea of a Savior who will simultaneously save us from the hands of our enemies and lead us in the paths of peace. They don't seem to go together, do they? Certainly not from our perspective. That's not usually how we do things. If we want to be saved from our enemies, what do? We buy a gun. If we want to be saved from our enemies, what do? We drop a bomb. That's how we're saved from our enemies. That's what we understand. To be saved from enemies is a totally separate thing in our minds from being led in the paths of peace. We might say, in fact, that being saved from our enemies, now that's a human response to a problem. We understand it from a human perspective. We defend ourselves in the face of a threat. That's what we do. But when we talk about being led in the paths of peace, that sounds like something totally different. In fact, that sounds downright otherworldly, to be led in the paths of peace. Because, honestly, most of the time we wonder, how could anybody but a fool lay down their weapons? How can anyone but a fool lay down their arms? Now, I don't have the answer to those questions. I don't understand how it is that we are to be led in the paths of peace in the world that we live in. I do not get it. But I feel in this question a challenge to me that I believe comes from God. It's been promised in the scriptures. The question is, how is it fulfilled? How does it work? What can we look for? What can we do? I find in these questions a challenge to my own spirit. And in them, I find definitive proof, actually, that Jesus is who the church says he is, that he is both fully human and fully divine. He comes promising protection from enemies. That's a very human kind of thing that we're looking for. But he also promises to lead us in the paths of peace, which we generally think of as something only God can do. He's both fully human and fully divine. We have a hard time understanding this. We have a hard time understanding almost everything about Jesus. And we have a hard time proclaiming him because we have a hard time believing. So it went with Zechariah, so it goes with us. We're silent because we don't know how we could possibly speak these words about this God who does things that we just don't understand. And so that's why instead, at large Christian university this week, the message that the president of that university shared with his people was, everybody buy yourself a gun. What he said specifically was, let's teach them a lesson before they show up here. I don't know that being saved is the same as being safe. I don't know that those are the same thing. We might want to believe that they are, but I don't think that they are. And during Advent, I feel driven once again to study this mystery. How does this work exactly? How do we take care of the people around us? How do we follow God in paths of peace? I don't know. But I want this Advent to understand more deeply the Savior who speaks of both of those things. And maybe when I understand those things, maybe I will be able to speak about them. You know, it's only after this child is born. It's only on the eighth day after John's birth that Zechariah is able to say again what he knows and what he understands and what he believes. Well, maybe when Christ is born once more in me, then I'll be able to speak about the things that I've learned, that I've been taught. Things that can only be understood by faith. It cannot be understood intellectually. Maybe then words will no longer fail me. The promises of God are promises that cannot be understood. I don't understand how it is that we can be rescued from the hands of our enemies and then serve God without fear in holiness and righteousness all our days. I don't know how that promise comes true in us. But this Advent, my prayer for us is that it might be born in us when Christ is born in us again. That's my prayer for us this Advent. We might understand the mysteries through the birth of Christ in us. Amen.
Hail to the Lord's of glory.
Amen. You may be seated. You know, everything that we have around us is the result of somebody offering what they had to God. And so as we come before God with our offerings this morning, I want to say thank you for giving. And if you're visiting with us today for the first time, we want to say you don't need to feel obligated to put anything in the plate. We're grateful to see you this morning and look forward to seeing you again very soon. Let's continue now by offering God our tithes and our offerings. Same words for the doxology, but the tune is different. But you stand as you're able.
Please pray with me. God of joy and justice, your prophet John once said to his followers, if you have two coats, give one to the poor. If you have extra food, give it away to those who are hungry. He knew of your compassion for the poor and hungry. He also knew the sheer joy that comes from passing on the gifts that you entrust to us. This very day, we trust that you want us to know such joy. And so we ask that you shower life-giving justice on those who will receive this offering and joy on those who give it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
As we we prepare to celebrate communion here this morning, I remind you that this table does not belong to the United Methodist Church or to any church. This table belongs to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's the one who issues the invitation, and that invitation is to all people. So I invite you, as you are led here this morning, to come and join us for communion here at the table. We're going to receive by intinction today, which means you'll be given a piece of bread to dip in the cup. We'll come by the center aisle and return by the side aisles. I'll encourage everyone to be in prayer for that person in front of you in the line, whether you know them or not, whether you know anything about their situation or not, so that every person can be prayed over individually here this morning. If you need gluten-free communion, that'll be available at the right-hand station. And if you need assistance, if you can't come forward for whatever reason, let the ushers know. We'll bring the elements to you. Let's continue with the great Thanksgiving.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because you are good, we offer to you this morning our joys and our celebrations and our thanksgivings. Are there joys that the congregation would like to share in prayer?
New jobs.
New jobs, yes.
Amen.
Amen.
New babies.
And new babies, yes. Amen. Yes, it's good to have you back in the choir loft, Linda. Yes.
Amen.
Oh, happy birthday, Anne.
She's happy that you shared that. Happy birthday, Anne.
And I celebrate that Sue Rayner's with us this morning as well. It's good to have you with us, Sue. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. We trust that when we gather in his name and we offer our prayers to you, that you hear us. And we come to the table this morning with many concerns on our hearts. What are some of those concerns that we'd like to share?
Louise Kent broke her arm.
Louise Kent, yes, for healing for Louise.
And several that have come from the congregation for Ron, who's dealing with health problems. For John Eaton, for safe travels as he goes back to Colorado. For Amanda, we ask for healing for her. And we also have a prayer here for our nation to keep an open and welcoming spirit even in the face of terrorism.
Finally, Lord, we thank you for your Son and for all that his coming means for our lives and for the world. By the baptism of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave to your church. You gave birth to the church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit.
On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. Then he broke the bread and shared it with his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, then, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He shared it with his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. With all the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. Invite those who will be serving at the table with us to come forward now.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for life and for the life of your Son, Jesus the Christ, who came into this world in a mysterious way. We may not understand it, but we know your love. And so as we continue to be your hands and your feet and your voice in this world, help to unfold that mystery, not just before us, but before all the world. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
There are certain mysteries of faith that cannot be understood. They have to be born in us. Go forth this Advent that Christ may be born in you. You may carry Christ into the world. Go forth in his love.